Director of the National Institutes of Health, and do you wish to
I'll make
say
a couple of very
with?
General comments, but then I'll see what you all want to talk about. Yes, I'm Francis Collins. I'm the Director of the National Institutes of Health. I'm here for part of yesterday and all day today to interact from wonderful colleagues here at UAB, to see some of the science that's going on, talk to some of the really exciting trainees who are coming along as our next generation of leaders, and to share with them some of my ideas about where I think medical research is heading. The talk I just gave, I picked out 10 areas that I thought were particularly exciting and talked about examples of where that might take us in the next decade, and was able to also point to, for almost all of those, things that are going on right here at UAB that are part of this leading edge of the possible. This is an incredibly exciting time for scientific research. Things that I would not have thought would happen in my lifetime are now happening, whether it's cancer immunotherapy, curing people with what used to be considered a terminal disease, whether it's the advances that are happening in gene therapy. We're now curing sickle cell disease in a few patients using a genetic approach. Whether it's all the advances in basic science that make it possible for us to look at what's happening in an individual cell, which we couldn't do before, or, which is very much on everybody's mind right now, moving forward as rapidly as humanly possible to develop treatments and vaccines for the coronavirus that is causing such stress right now in our country. All of those things are things that I, as the NIH director, have a chance to watch over, but they only really happen because of the talented people around the country in institutions like this that we support. With that $41.7 billion funding that we get from the Congress on behalf of the people, we support about 400,000 scientists here in Alabama. There's about $380 million that comes from NIH to the state, and the majority of that comes to UAB. So as I go around and hear about science that we're supporting, it makes me feel very good that we're getting our money's worth, because this is a wonderful gathering of really smart, talented, visionary people. So I don't know what will be on your minds. I'm glad to talk about whatever. I have a feeling coronavirus might come up, but I would love it if we talked about some other things too. So what's on your mind?
Dr. Collins, one of the things you mentioned in your presentation is you think coronavirus could be here in Alabama in the next week or two.
Well, if you look at what's happened in the United States, just turn the clock back about a month where we got our first case or two starting to pop up, and look where we are today with over 200 cases. And in my own county of Montgomery County, Maryland, just in the last 24 hours, we have our first three cases. And until yesterday, we didn't have any. There are cases in Georgia. There are cases in Florida. It's hard to imagine that somehow the magic will happen and there will be no further distribution of this. So the betting odds would certainly be that Alabama also will have individuals who are afflicted with this condition. And now that testing is more widely available, it's more likely that we'll begin to discover it in the next couple of weeks, as opposed to previously where tests were not so available, and so there might have been cases we didn't even know about.
Can you talk a little bit about the progress being made for developing a vaccine for the coronavirus?
So this vaccine, which is what we very much will hope will be available in the future, needs to be able to be given to anybody and protect them from this particular very significant infection. There are various ways to make vaccines. Traditionally, they take many years from the start of a program to having something that's approved and widely available. We're trying to speed that up in dramatic ways. In this instance, the vaccine was started within 24 hours after the Chinese had published the actual sequence of the letters of the RNA that make up this coronavirus. And that was then, as a partnership between NIH and a company called Moderna, turned into something that could be injected into mice in the space of just a couple of weeks. The mouse experiments look very good, that this does seem to be producing antibodies, and that's what vaccines are all about. And so we will be ready within a very short period of time to begin a human trial with about 45 patients. That's what's called a phase one trial, basically, to find out is it going to be completely safe. If that looks good, and will those people generate antibodies, then we have to expand that to a trial of perhaps a few hundred patients. And if that looks good, then finding a commercial partner to be able to scale this up to what may need to be hundreds of millions of doses. All of those things take a lot of time. So even though this is happening at record speed, Tony Fauci, who's the leader of this effort at NIH, would say we should not count on having a vaccine in less than a year. Yeah. We are still learning about it, and there's so many things I wish we had solid data about. We're going to get that in the coming weeks and months. It does seem that this virus seems to be particularly good at transmissibility, that if you are around somebody who's infected, your risk of catching it too seems to be pretty substantial. Maybe the most dramatic example of that is the Diamond Princess, where roughly a third of the people on that boat ultimately got infected. Just because it started to spread. And that tells you that this is something that spreads quite easily. The other thing we don't really know, and I wish we had a better number for, is what is the fatality rate? The World Health Organization, just looking at the numbers that we know right now, quoted 3.4%. That probably is an overestimate because there's a lot of milder cases that aren't being diagnosed and therefore aren't being counted. But it seems likely the mortality rate will be somewhere around the 1% to 2% level. And that may not sound like a particularly high level, but when you consider that influenza has a mortality rate of about 1/10 that, about 0.1% to 0.2%, this is a very serious condition indeed when you consider what might happen if it's truly widespread in the world and in our country. All of those things are data that I wish we knew. I particularly wish we knew whether we already might have an effective therapeutic. And this is a place where UAB has played a critical role going back a few years before we ever knew how much it was going to matter. There is a drug called remdesivir made by Gilead. It has been a partnership with UAB's virus center to understand how this particular antiviral might work. And it is, of all the things that are being tried right now, probably the most promising antiviral for people who are really sick with coronavirus. But we don't know yet whether it's actually going to work. There's a clinical trial underway in China. There's another underway that we're supporting in Nebraska. Give it a month, and we might have a better sense about whether we do have an effective, specific therapeutic. Because we're going to need that. From what we can tell, people who get really sick with this disease end up in the ICU with very serious pneumonia. If we had something that could stop the virus from replicating earlier than that point where people are really sick, it would be enormously helpful. So watch that space. Remdesivir is the name of the drug. And again, UAB, over the course of the last many years, has been working on this, thinking that it might be a good treatment for SARS, which kind of came and went, or MERS, which is still happening in the Middle East but hasn't reached our country much. But now, maybe it's the best hope we've got for COVID-19.
And you mentioned something about some issues potentially with scaling up that treatment if it proves to be effective. Does the NIH have any role in that, or is that something Gilead will have to?
So we're part of the administration's team to try to bring together all of the experts from public health, from research, from Homeland Security, from pipeline analysis, from preparedness and response. And again, Tony Fauci, who's the director of the NIH Institute for Infectious Diseases, is our representative there. And they are certainly looking hard at the question of how could you be sure that there would be enough remdesivir if it turns out that the clinical trials are successful. And so we're getting a pretty good handle on what the inventory is of drug that's already there. There is this concern that if more needs to be made in a hurry, the whole issue of the pipeline for all of pharmaceutical compounds is affected by what is happening in China, because many of those components are made in China, and there isn't at the moment another great alternative. This has revealed to us something that maybe we hadn't been paying that much attention to, is how vulnerable we are as a global community for something like pharmaceuticals, where certain parts of that industry are focused only in a few places. And then something like this happens, and you begin to realize that you don't have a good backup plan. We're going to have to think about that.
You alluded to this a little bit, but how impressed are you with the work that UAB does, not just on coronavirus, but as a whole when it comes to all the research?
Well, in coming here, I had the chance to look at a lot of the publications that are coming out of investigators here at UAB, and whether it's in the area of looking at stem cells for cardiovascular disease, or whether it's looking at the microbiome and its role in terms of all kinds of intestinal and other kinds of issues, UAB is right there in a very significant leadership role. I talked a bit about this program called All of Us. We're enrolling 1 million Americans in a long-term study of health and illness, a really wonderfully, remarkably radical idea, and all of these people are participants and partners with us, and UAB here in Alabama has been one of the most effective partners in this, and particularly in reaching out to groups that are traditionally left out of research and encouraging them to look at this. It may not be for everybody, but a lot of people find this to be pretty exciting to take part of this, and they get all this data back about themselves. Program, in case anybody's listening, you can join too just by going to joinallofus.org. So I would say of the maybe top 50 or so institutions in the United States that we support through biomedical research, UAB is extremely strong and getting stronger every year. They're on that upward trajectory, and I can see that by being here and interacting with the scientists.
We've got time for one more question, preferably non-coronavirus.
What's the main thing that you hope that people who had a chance to see your lecture, what's the main thing you hope that they will take away?
Yeah. I'm particularly anxious to encourage young scientists who are just getting started. They're our future. We've had in the United States some ups and downs in terms of their support. If you go back 7 years to when we had a really tough year for biomedical research with the sequester that happened at that point, morale got pretty much hit hard by that, and a lot of young scientists really began to get discouraged about whether there was a career path. Things are so much better now. The Congress has supported us, and again, Senator Shelby's had a lot to do with this. Over the last 5 years, NIH's budget has gone up almost 40%. And so this is a great time to be doing research, both because of the resources and because of the science. And if there's one message I hope to get across, it's to that person who's thinking about where they're going to go when they finish graduate school or medical school or maybe a residency or maybe a postdoctoral fellowship. And I want them to feel inspired and energized and to get out there and ask a really important question and use their research skills to answer it.
Thank you.
All right, thank you all very much.
Appreciate it.